Need to get into the energy of the podcast again because we've not done this for a while.
I know. It's weird. Because like I was thinking like obviously we're a bit late starting today because I've been writing lesson plans ready for my return to school tomorrow. Or actually more
Ooh, you're
accurate.
going tomorrow.
More no, not tomorrow.
Oh, well, not tomorrow. Yeah, is
More
it
accurate.
Friday or Saturday?
It's Saturday today, I think.
Okay.
More accurately, I have been writing lesson plan for my first lesson on Monday. I shall do the other one later or tomorrow. Yeah, not later because I will have had a bottle of South African wine later. I have just been to El Cooperative. Shall we begin? Shall we commence and begin?
Okay, if you want to.
Yeah, my plan is to later, if we finish in time, me and Mum are going to watch His Dark Material, the new Jimmy Carr stand-up
Oh, yeah.
on Netflix, which sounds worrying. If his other material wasn't dark by comparison, then,
I think he's like released a book, so it's probably a bit more emotionally substantial, I suppose,
well,
than.
the description says that he's just self-described the jokes that he uses as career enders.
Yeah, but he does that for a lot of his jokes.
Yeah, so shall we begin?
Sure. Now we get to this bit.
I don't know what happens. I've forgotten. It's been a while. How long has it been?
Hold on,
Oh,
I got the YouTube up to check where we last left off. Only a month, apparently, but.
now, I've got to be careful because one, I think it was hiding my own self view that stopped it recording my camera last time. But
Right.
sharing my screen shouldn't do that, should it?
No.
No. Okay. Well, we'll see. When did you say it was?
About a month ago, we stopped uploading at least.
Not too bad. Okay.
It felt like longer.
Well, we've had Christmas, haven't we?
Yeah, I've been on a bit of a weird journey with sleep deprivation over the last couple of weeks.
I noticed you messaged me at about 20 past 8 this morning, which I thought.
Oh, well, I actually got up at 7 a.m. today,
Really?
so that was okay.
About 4 hours.
Well, because I hadn't slept the day before and was trying to stay awake as long as possible so I'd wake up at a normal time.
Is that in preparation? Oh, you don't start back for another week, though, do you?
No.
No, part-timer. Anyway, I shall have to pop by tomorrow because I've got some post for you. Anyway, shall we commence? Because I've got
Sure.
battle in Aberdeen in the evening, so I shall pop by. Anyway, all valuable podcast material here.
Well, I don't know. This should probably be edited out, to be honest, but you usually don't edit these.
Real life.
Anyway. Do you remember what you're supposed to say?
No. And I'm the author.
After I say my bit, you say, and I'm the orbiter, and then we get into it.
Right, okay.
Hello, Internet. I'm Fireball. Wanker.
No,
Right,
orbit.
we're doing that again. Hello, Internet. I am Fireball.
And I'm the orbiter.
And welcome to episode 6, I suppose, of Breaking Borders.
Yeah, it must be.
South Africa part 2. Possibly the last part. We'll see how much we get through today.
Okay.
Because there's a fair amount to go through. If you haven't listened to the first part, last time we got up to around about 1870, when gold and diamonds were discovered in South Africa, thus sort of igniting a push for united South Africa, as well as tensions rising between the English-speaking and Dutch or Afrikaans-speaking groups.
Indeed. So do you have any preamble to get through, any kind of news-related stuff, or is it just South African news we're looking at?
I mean, there's a lot of
is he gonna present... Is he going to make it through the week? Is he going to make it?
I think it's going to be like an internal Tory party matter, but we'll get onto South African news because that's what we tend to do.
Yeah.
We do this bit for breaking bollocks,
I said to you before, I've been up to the co-op to get a bottle of South African wine. Bruce Jack, it's called, and it's a world's most awarded... the world's most admired wine brands 2021. It's a Shiraz. But I just want to point out that I brought it back in a carrier bag, not a suitcase.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was the thing that just made me think, what the fuck? Because apart from anything else, bringing wine in a suitcase back in, it's like, but you've got to think of the context. That was like slap bang in the middle of the worst part of the lockdown for most of the country. And somebody has had to go into a shop that sells wine with a suitcase, ask them to fill it with bottles of wine. And it's just like, I just don't get it.
Anyway, we'll try and keep off that. I mean, if we get onto the modern politics of South Africa, a lot of that stuff might become relevant.
It should be fairly safe at the moment, shouldn't they? They're nowhere near the Pacific, are they? Have you seen about the volcano that's erupted?
Oh,
somewhere near Tonga.
Oh, okay. I mean, there's a lot of volcanoes that erupt along the Pacific, but...
This is a pretty big event, apparently. The Pacific coasts of America and somewhere else
have been... Well, I assume Tonga.
I can't remember where it is. But Pacific, I know Tonga itself has had some tidal waves coming ashore. Where is it? US and Japan have warned people on the coast to move away from water. It happened, or how long it takes for tsunamis to travel any distance, really.
I have brought up just a few stories on South Africa, which might come up if we do get to them. So the first one's about actually the leadership of South Africa's ruling party possibly changing hands. So South Africa is currently ruled by the African National Congress, or ANC, it's been ruling since the 90s. But as we'll get onto, the guy before the current guy was really corrupt, which has kind of left bad taste in a lot of people's mouth. Oh, cheers.
Grapes going. What are you on? Dr. Pepper?
Dr. Pepper and vodka.
Ah, I was on rum and Dr. Pepper last night.
Which is a good mixer.
Yeah. Please continue.
But yeah, so I mean, they've basically been in power since apartheid ended.
Yeah.
Fairly safely. The second place party is generally the National Party, or whatever they are now, who were the racist party back in the day.
Yeah.
So they're not really going to get back into power.
That really does make me think, like, the 1990s were pretty... There were some pretty major political events happened, weren't there? Well, I mean, two things stick out particularly to me. Is the Berlin Wall coming down.
And that was 89, actually, but... Germany reunified later in the 90s, but...
Okay. But that and apartheid coming to an end as well is two pretty major events, weren't they?
Yeah. I mean, Germany reuniting is kind of symbolic of the Soviet Union breaking apart as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, I didn't realize researching more stuff further ahead how crazy things got, like how much of an outlier South Africa was. I mean, you probably remember some stuff
Yeah, I
from
mean,
the news in the
actually,
80s.
for one of the music tracks, actually, I'm going to look up. It's not actually South African music, but I do have a song by a sort of rock metal band, I think called GCR, but it's called South Africa, and the words in it kind of really portray the atmosphere around the world at the time. Like literally, the whole world was basically saying, "Look, you've got to fucking sort this mess out," you know.
We'll hopefully get onto that. But we might only have time to get up to like the 1940s if, depending on how fast we go.
I'll save that.
Other stories are kind of sports related news that's not very important. Also, South Africa's state power company is shutting down nuclear power plants, which is kind of interesting, both because I learned apparently South Africa, while the world was kind of quite heavily criticizing the apartheid regime, developed nuclear weapons and also set up things like a state energy company so that they wouldn't have to rely on the world that was quickly turning against them
Yeah.
for its energy supplies, basically. So it both sort of starting to shut down nuclear power plants, and there being a state energy company is quite significant in the sort of politics of apartheid.
Yeah. Because I'm looking back at what companies were state-owned here when I was younger, and certainly British Telecom, British Rail. I don't think energy was. I'm not sure though.
Also, something very significant. It did happen a little while ago, but Desmond Tutu died.
Yes, indeed. Was going to ask what he. I know he was. He's a. Was he a bishop or something?
He
Archbishop.
was an Anglican archbishop in South Africa, but he was quite an important part in both towards the end of apartheid and building the sort of post-apartheid South Africa. He headed up something called the Truth and Reconciliation Commission
Right.
or agency, I can't remember precisely, which basically their point was to both try and, in some cases, grant amnesty to people that had committed basically crimes against humanity under apartheid.
Yeah.
And the investigations uncovered a lot of the stuff that we now know about what was going on under apartheid that was previously kept quite secret by the government. But if you want to jump into where we last left off, so we are getting through some stuff.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so trying to find rough point. Yeah, so discovery of gold and diamonds. So this causes thousands of people to flood to the sort of Boer republics that had been set up, the Orange and Transvaal, the Orange Free State and Transvaal, where there'd been like diamonds reported in search of fortunes. The colonial administrator at the time, Theophilus Shepstone, tried interfering with Zulu politics, and also at the time the underbelly succession, which the underbelly sort of ended up in modern day Zimbabwe because they were pushed out of South Africa by the Boers.
Mm-hmm.
He ends up supporting Martinus Pretorius as leader of the Transvaal. What?
That sounds like a Roman. Sounds like somebody out of a Monty Python film.
Well, I think he's actually the guy that Pretoria is named after.
All right, okay.
One of the current capitals. It might just be one of a number of Pretoriuses. I'm not sure. Eventually, Lobengula, who I suppose is an underbelly chief, ends up as leader. But they're sort of trying to put someone, the Transvaal leader, on the throne, I suppose. So Basutoland or Lesotho gets annexed, and that means that the British begin seizing the diamond fields there. But they get competition from the Griqua, the Tlaping, and Boers. And by 1871, there's a multilingual mining camp known as Kimberley that had grown to about 50,000 just from this diamond rush.
Yeah.
So at the beginning of this sort of diamond rush, you had like fairly small claims made where individual diggers would find small fortunes. However, this begins to get industrialized and centralized. And so at the beginning, it was fairly equal for both black and white miners. But once it industrializes, owners are usually white and the laborers are usually black and get much less of the profits, obviously. So we have a diamond zone that gets claimed by the Orange Free State, the South African Republic, which I believe is what the Cape Colony became, the Western Griqua, and the Tswana chiefs.
Is that something to do with the Dutch connection, the Orange?
Yeah, because they're a Boer state.
Right.
I mean, it's named after a river, which I was assumed named by Boers, the Orange River.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So they have a hearing about this diamond zone, in which the Griqua sort of win ownership of this diamond zone. But the British basically try and persuade him to use their protection against the Boers, and so annex it as their own, as Griqua land west. So these annexations kind of beginning to step towards the Federation that the colonial secretary back in the UK, Lord Carnarvon, was wanting in South Africa. And this was under the Disraeli government, if you've heard of Benjamin Disraeli.
The Benjamin Disraeli, yeah, I'm not sure. Yeah. I don't know much about... He was a UK prime minister, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's about as much as I know my history shit. But for some reason, I don't know why, but there's a connection there, is there, with the Suez Canal?
Yeah. I'm not sure precisely, but
maybe it was...
We'll probably get into that if we talk about Egypt at some point.
Right, okay. I just there's a connection when I was doing... I was going to say current affairs, but it was maybe when we used to do current affairs, when I was at my posh private school before I got myself kicked out, we went into the history of current affairs that were going on at the time. And I think it maybe came up in that, because we never got that far with, we never got into that recent history with, as far as I took history as a subject. But the current affairs part, we probably looked at the history of what was going on in South Africa, because apartheid was a big thing then when I was a teenager.
Yeah, it would have been.
Yeah.
Sort of the peak of how crazy things got in the 80s.
Mm.
Right. So while this is a step towards the Federation, it doesn't really meet the colonial secretary's ambitions. They wanted to like unite all the republics so that they'd be self-governing and also part of the British Empire, but doesn't really do what they were wanting it to do. Okay, so when Mpande, who's the current ruler of the Zulu at this time, he dies in 1872. So Cetshwayo, who had been ruling sort of as a regent in his stead, officially becomes king of Zululand. But he'd pretty much been ruling it for about a decade by now.
Mm.
So Lord Carnarvon tries to put together more concrete federation plans in 1875. He tries persuading the Cape and Orange Free State. However, they're not really accepting his proposals. The South African Republic is the Transvaal, not the Cape Colony. So the South African Republic or Transvaal is bankrupt at the time, and also basically just got humiliated by being beaten by the Pedi. So their military and economy are kind of crumbling at this point. So Shepstone invades the Transvaal in 1877, and in 1879 crush the Pedi that were still around there.
Right. So South Africa still doesn't technically exist in its current form at this point.
No.
So it's quite a recent country then, because some of the countries we looked at in the past have obviously been a long time in development, but
It only actually becomes the Union of South Africa in 1910.
Right. Okay.
So colonial troops basically run over the societies that had resisted European control. And eventually the century of conflict that had been raging on in the Cape ends in the Cape Joza War in 1878. The Cape Colony also defeats many rebellions in Griqualand, the Transkei, and Basutu land. And by the late 1870s, the British begin to see the Zulu Kingdom as a major threat to their idea of a federation. And so in 1879, British troops invade Zululand and begin the Anglo-Zulu War, which you may have heard of.
Yeah, I'm not sure I've heard of it specifically called that, but I know we've had tanglings with... I didn't realise it was called Zululand. I'd thought Zulus were, it's difficult, isn't it? That word tribe, but it's just kind of, that's how they were kind of portrayed in my youth. Zulu were portrayed as a tribe, really. But you're saying it was actually a country.
Well, it kind of, for a lot of people's, that weren't used to all these treaties and like feudal claims over land. Like the way that we define borders isn't really the same.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, like nowadays you've got the United Nations that recognize countries and borders, don't you? But before that existed, it must have been quite a fluid kind of arbitrary kind of point of view thing, really.
Yeah. But you just sort of have people roughly of the ethnic group of Zulus lived in this area. And so this is how the British categorized it, probably more than Zulu people themselves.
Yeah.
So under Mpande, the Zulu's military had significantly expanded, and Cetshwayo managed to use this against the British invaders and massively slow down the invasion. I think they used quite a lot of fairly clever tactics as well. One that I'm aware of is soaking hides in water. Basically makes your shields bulletproof.
All right, okay.
Which is quite a useful thing. Also sort of guerrilla tactics, that sort of thing. Knowing the land a lot better. So within the Cape Colony itself, Afrikaners and English speakers begin to sort of have political conflicts. So in 1879, the Afrikaner Bond is established, which sort of is an alliance that represents the anti-British Afrikaner sentiment. These are both like white European groups, but in the end, this gets transformed into more looking at the commercial interests of the Cape. So in 1881, the Transvaal Boers, who had previously been annexed by the British after going bankrupt, fight for independence and actually defeat the British in 1881. And that basically ends this idea of a united federation for quite some time, since there's still significant parts of South Africa that are unable to be united under British rule. So in 1884, Germany actually annexes Namibia, which is to the northwest of South Africa.
I'd just like to quickly, because obviously this is kind of relevant at the moment with Russia's kind of involvement. I know they've already annexed Crimea, haven't they? What does annex the country actually mean?
Officially kind of bringing it into your own territory. Rather than just occupying it, that's where your troops are just in an area. Basically saying, I plan to own this for a long time.
Yeah. So, I mean, in terms of how that relates to, obviously, the way things are now, the United Nations kind of has a defined set of countries and where their territory is. The whole thing with Russia declaring Crimea annexed, is that recognized by the UN? I know it's not relevant to South Africa, but does a country literally just have to say, right, that belongs to us now?
Well, I mean, it's not, it has to be recognized by, I think, all members of the Security Council, and five members of the Security Council have a veto on any matters.
Yeah.
Which I think the US would probably veto, as well as France and the UK.
So
so it's that border's not officially recognized, but it is the
effective
border.
But back then it was more a case of just exerting power there and saying so. Yeah.
I mean, certainly in Namibia, I mean, it was at the time called I think Southwest Africa by Germany.
Yeah.
Or that in German. But the Transvaal also claims the territory to the west. So the British decide to counter basically the sort of boxing in of territory by claiming or designating the territory Bechuana Land, which later becomes Botswana, as a crown colony. So in 1886, the world's largest gold fields are found at Witwatersrand, and gold mining accelerates, and so does industrialization, which kind of kickstarts South Africa's economy, but also means that the racial divides in South Africa get larger and larger as industrialization goes on.
That, I mean, I'm assuming that a major factor in that is the fact that the rich are getting richer very quickly.
Yeah, and they're the ones with the power to change anyone's conditions, and they'll change it to benefit people that look like them.
Yep. It's always been the case, isn't it? The poverty gap.
So, unfortunately for the Zulus, in the end, just the sheer amount of firepower the British had is enough to defeat them, particularly in the Battle of Rorke's Drift, which is relatively well known. The Zulus get politically dismembered by the British. Colonial policies start a civil war in 1883, and Zululand is annexed in 1887.
We did it again.
Yeah, so the Transkei is still up independent up until about 1894, but various parts are annexed throughout the 1880s and 1890s by the British. And so this previously large reserve for African peoples left in South Africa in their own territory gets just eaten up by the British, basically.
Mm.
Okay, so we get to a point that's still fairly relevant in South Africa today, the De Beers Corporation, which you may have heard of in relation to diamond mining.
Yeah.
Because they hold a monopoly to this day on basically all diamonds. They're the reason diamonds are so expensive, basically.
Is that
because they own all of them?
I know. Technically, I mean, it's kind of claimed that it's an internationally illegal concept, but it happens with OPEC. Is that basically, well, it's not even a cartel, is it? A cartel is a group of organizations or countries that control something, but this was a single entity that controlled these diamonds.
Yep. And they still do.
Yeah. So,
an example of this is zirconium is actually rarer than diamonds, but seen as the cheap option because they overprice diamonds, and they're the reason why diamond wedding rings are a thing. That's an advertising campaign by the De Beers Mining Corporation.
But you can synthesize diamonds, can't you? Or can you not?
Yep, I think so. But
could people not just do that? And
well, they push for the authentic ones, which are the ones that are mined.
It's a bit like the champagne argument in France.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But because they control all of them, they make big advertising campaigns. It's like, oh, you should spend a lot of your salary on your wedding ring.
There must be diamonds elsewhere in the world, though. It can't just be South Africa.
Well, they buy up the ones elsewhere in the world, though.
Right.
So the De Beers Mining Corporation at this time is controlled by Cecil Rhodes, who you may know as the guy that Rhodesia is named after.
Yeah, I've heard of this guy. Was there not a statue or something that was controversial of him?
Yeah, he's certainly a controversial figure, let's say that.
Yeah.
So De Beers becomes the sole producer of diamonds in South Africa. And so at this point, white laborers are usually overseers or skilled laborers, and the majority of labor comes from black migrants who mostly come from Mozambique. And these workers are, of course, paid much, much less than white workers and are housed in compounds that are owned by the corporation. Which is a practice that was used in Brazil when mining similar things. Mm. So in 1890, Hofmeyr, who was the politician heading up the Afrikaner Bond, backed Cecil Rhodes to become Prime Minister of the Cape. He does so and then sends a pioneer column, which occupies the land of Zimbabwe, and that becomes Rhodesia.
Mm.
So, quite a lot of the English speaking voters in the Cape at this time, possibly surprisingly, were actually black men and black men who supported black peasants. Whereas the people that supported the bond, Afrikaners, were generally white voters. Also, quite a lot of English speaking white voters were hostile to the black farmers. Yeah. And so they wanted to restrict voting qualifications more.
Mm-hmm.
So this sort of follows a trend as more and more territories get annexed, meaning more black people coming to the Cape Colony, and more becoming literate, and so passing for the franchise requirements. Mm-hmm. Political educational bodies are created, such as the first black-owned newspapers and churches, and also mixed race and Indian people in South Africa found political organizations in the Cape, Natal and Transvaal.
Right. Yeah, this is getting on towards, I remember the first part of the film Gandhi being set in South Africa. I'm not sure what era that was, but yeah,
we'll get onto that soon.
Yeah.
So in the Transvaal, we have a government led by a man called Paul Kruger, and the mining industry is largely made up of mining magnates from out with the Transvaal, and these are called Outlanders.
Called Krugerrands. What are they?
I don't know. I don't know if they're related.
I shall look it up while you're carrying on.
So a lot of them are excluded from voting, which kind of pisses them off. And so this gives the British an opportunity to basically conspire with the mining industry magnates.
Okay, sorry. Just quickly, Krugerrands, they're gold coins that were minted by the Republic of South Africa in 1967 to help promote South African gold to the international markets.
Okay. Oh, they probably are related then.
Yeah. Carry on. Sorry.
Okay, so the British try and work with these outlanders. Basically, the idea was that the outlanders would have an uprising in Johannesburg, which would be supported by an armed invasion from Bechuanaland or Botswana in order to restore order. Mm. However, the uprising that was supposed to happen never did, and the armed invasion from Botswana still occurred.
Right. However,
without the sort of support from the uprising, the forces are rounded up. The leader is imprisoned, and Rhodes has to resign because the leader was his own lieutenant, Jameson.
Okay.
So basically, Cecil Rhodes, as Prime Minister of the Cape, is caught out supporting an invasion of the Transvaal behind closed doors and trying to do this all sneaky.
Oops.
The colonial secretary back in the UK manages to conceal his involvement, but this sort of deepens the Anglo-Boer divide because the Transvaal is a Boer republic and the Cape is sort of a mixed English-speaking Boer area.
Mm.
So the Gaza and Ndebele kingdoms between 1893 and 1896 get invaded, and in 1898 the Venda get crushed, and by 1900 there are no autonomous African communities. What?
Sorry, did that come through?
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't think
what
it.
What the fuck was that?
It was me just lining up some music to play at some point. I didn't think it would come through until I clicked to share the debrief. What's it?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, by 1900, there are no autonomous communities left in South Africa that are African. God.
Sorry, that's really put me off now. Carry on.
Right. So, in 1898, Kruger is re-elected and tries to negotiate with Alfred Milner, who's the governor of the Cape, on the issue of Outlanders getting to vote in the Transvaal. However, Milner privately declares war has got to come, basically. So the Cape and the Free State, so the Free State's kind of tied to the Transvaal's interests, try to mediate the negotiations. But in the end, in 1899, the two Boer republics basically give an ultimatum to the British Empire. And the ultimatum expires, which causes the Boer republics to invade Natal, which at this time was a British territory.
Right.
So in 1899, this is just a bit of an update on the gold mining situation. We'll get to the war soon. This is just kind of towards the end of the century, wrapping up what the situation in South Africa is generally. Mm. So South African gold mining at this point represents a third of the world's gold, which is quite significant considering a lot of wealth at this time was measured in gold.
Yeah.
Mm. And just on the sort of religious front, because we haven't really talked about that much. So since the 1820s, missionaries were trying to Christianize indigenous communities, introducing them to European goods. This kind of destroys the traditional African way of life. For a time, some peasant farmers use European technologies and participate in capitalist society early on, but the legal and political discrimination limits how much they're really able to do this, meaning most are driven out of business in the decades after the South African War, which we're just about to get into.
Right.
So the government of Lord Salisbury, who I believe is British Prime Minister at this time, basically wanted to secure hegemony in South Africa. However, the Boer republics were fighting for independence.
Can you just explain to me what hegemony is?
Total control, basically.
Right, thank you.
Dominance, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
So about 500,000 British troops fight against around 87,000 Republicans, as well as Cape rebels and foreign volunteers. So quite a significant size difference in terms of troops.
Mm-hmm.
However, the Boers at this point know the terrain pretty well. The Afrikaner people supported them, and the British apparently had pretty poor tactics. So it's generally seen the South African War as kind of, because it's between Afrikaner and the British Empire, as a white war, basically. Mm-hmm. However, black people did participate in the war quite extensively, usually as labor, but also at least 10,000 black men fought for the British, because the British kind of used this language of equality after the war, which we'll see they go back on. And sort of betray the black people who had signed up to fighting for the British with the idea that this would get rid of the racism of the Afrikaner republics.
That's just not cricket, you know.
So at the beginning, the Boer were actually attacking, which causes the British to reinforce South African garrisons in 1900. At this point, the Boer commandos can't face British forces head on without dying, basically. So they move to guerrilla warfare. This is actually shown in the film The King's Man, which we recently saw. The commander of the British, Lord Kitchener, basically implements a scorched earth policy against the Boers and all that support them. Yeah. They destroy arms, blockade the countryside, and place civilians in concentration camps.
I'd like to just point out that if that particular aspect of that film is accurate, it's probably one of the only things that is.
Yeah, that was the part that I was like, oh, that's... I'm surprised that they mentioned the concentration camps in that film.
Yeah.
So about 25,000 Afrikaner women and children die of malnutrition and disease in these concentration camps. And in separate camps, over 14,000 black people die. This causes quite a lot of controversy back home from the liberal opposition party in Britain. So by the end of the war, the Boer forces sue for peace in 1902. The Treaty of Vereeniging is... sorry?
No, I was just laughing. Whatever. I don't know what the correct pronunciation is, but I was amused at your attempt to...
It's Dutch.
Oh, okay.
Basically, the British have complete military victory. However, there's the point of the voting rights for black people, which in the treaty it said would be addressed once self-government is restored to the Boer republics, which basically means the white minority gets to decide the fate of the black majority. Not really surprising.
Which kind of carried on until...
Well, it keeps getting worse from here on out, is the thing.
Until apartheid finished, wasn't it?
Because you'd expect things to be getting progressively better over time, but yeah, up until the 90s, things just keep getting worse and worse for black people.
Yeah.
Black communities had faced a lot of hardship leading up to this war. There's quite a lot of droughts and cattle disease. Black South Africans, as I said, mainly favoured the British, as they had promised equal laws and equal liberty to black people. But the treaty basically betrays this, which sparks a lot of protests, which are trying to prevent the formation of a white-ruled union in South Africa. Similar protests happen in organizations among politically conscious colored, which is basically, I'm going to use colored in inverted quotes, but it's generally the term used to describe mixed race people in South Africa. It's not really a politically correct term because it's just kind of, it's a weird, very racialized term that's just not good, but like it's kind of hard to talk about distinct groups in South Africa that are treated politically different without using that term.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, politically conscious colored and Indian communities, which they all found a national organization called the African Political Organization in 1902, which lobbies for colored rights and forms links with the black organizations at the time. I imagine this is the sort of thing that Gandhi would have been a part of, which we'll get into soon. So Milner, who's currently governor of the Cape Colony, moves the headquarters from Cape Town to Pretoria to be closer to the Transvaal, basically trying to anglicize the areas by moving in British settlers, and also making education taught only in English, basically. However, this makes the Afrikaners just angrier and more nationalistic. Milner was sort of prioritizing economic recovery, wanting to get mining profits back after the war. He hires a lot of cheap indentured labor from China, actually, which these laborers would do like their share and then return to China. But the sort of standards that they were treated with would be used for colored laborers as well. So this the sort of cheaper labor undercuts the power of black workers and grows the value of gold production at the same time. The financial and agricultural reforms after the war also pressured black peasants to work for white farmers. Changes in town planning are all based on a principle of segregation at this point. So in 1905, the South African Native Affairs Committee publishes a report proposing separation of black and white land ownership. Systematic urban segregation, creating black locations, removing black squatters from white farms and replacing them with wage laborers, and segregating black and white people politically. So this report is kind of used as the basis for the many segregation laws that are to come for decades now.
I don't know how that sort of thing actually gets... I don't know if ratified is the right word, but how it's actually allowed to happen, how they justify it to the point where it can... I mean, I suppose they only have to justify it within their own borders if the rest of the world's kind of looking on and not really able to do much.
I mean, it's not really the rest of the world where this is the situation in a lot of African colonies. It's kind of a situation where it's just racism was necessitated really by economics, really. Unfortunately, the sort of system that had developed meant it was very profitable to see certain people as less than human.
Yeah. That sounds familiar.
Okay, so we're getting on to Gandhi's involvement in South Africa now. So Indians in the Transvaal are led by Gandhi. They resist discriminatory legislation. And it's in these years between 1906 and 1909 that Gandhi develops the method of satyagraha, which means non-violent non-compliance. Which would be later used in India to win independence.
Quite relevant here at the moment.
Yeah. it's kind of the tactics that groups like Extinction Rebellion use, and our government right now is trying to make illegal if it's a nuisance, if it could be seen as a disruption to anyone.
Yeah, it's just a quick digression. It's good to see that some of the protesters, the ones that glued themselves to trains during the Extinction Rebellion protests in 2019, were acquitted.
Well, because they were illegally arrested, they're now trying to make it legal to arrest them and imprison them for, I think, up to a year.
One of the big things I didn't realize about this Kill the Bill malarkey that's going on. Malarkey is probably the wrong word because I know American it means something a bit different, but is that part of this bill is that the British government will be able to remove someone's British citizenship without actually telling them.
Yep. See, it was something a lot of people warned about over the Shamina Begum case, that would be used to...
Somebody removes your citizenship. Is it just like when the next time you need to prove you're British, it just doesn't work? I don't know. I don't understand how you can remove a citizenship without telling someone. Is that just a case that suddenly you'll be deported? Or I suppose, you like with Shamima Begum, they can remove their citizenship when they're not actually in the country, so it's just a case that they're not allowed back in.
Yeah, previously that was only allowed if there was no way to contact them, but now they can do it just without contacting, which won't be used racistly at all, I'm sure.
No, well, I mean, our powers abroad obviously haven't been used in a racist fashion in the past, so...
No, of course not.
So continue with where you were at.
So the generals of the former Borough Republics basically formed an opposition to Milner. The Liberal government, which was now in power in Britain, allows responsible government in 1907, and Afrikaner parties begin winning elections in the Transvaal. So there's quite a lot of concern in Britain over these Afrikaner parties. However, this sort of concern disappears when it's clear that most of the Afrikaner parties agreed on economic issues around mining. And so agreement between white people in South Africa was sought. So in 1908, a national convention is called in Durban, and Afrikaner parties and the Prime Minister of the Cape opt for a unitary state, as with English and Dutch as the official languages.
Who was the Prime
Minister as well? What?
Who was the Prime Minister of the Cape at that point?
Milner, I believe.
Yeah, he took over from Cecil Rhodes. Yeah.
Yep. After the whole business with the conspiring with mining magnates to invade somewhere, and then they did it anyway. And this unitary state would have parliamentary sovereignty. Basically, the parliament would be able to rule on most matters, whereas the British government couldn't really do much unless it was to do with foreign affairs, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And executive authority being given to a governor general, advised by the cabinet elected by parliament.
Right.
However, the delegates disagree on who should be given franchise. The Cape delegates wanted a sort of colorblind system. However, the Borough Republics wanted whites being the only people allowed to vote. So they compromised basically by keeping things the way that they were before. So in the Cape, they would allow people of all races to vote. And in the former Borough Republics, they would just have white-only electorates. However, in both, only white people were allowed to be political representatives, and women's suffrage isn't considered until, I think, 1930, if I remember correctly.
Mm.
So black people hold their own convention at the same time, called the South African Native Convention, which is... sort of represents an important step towards a national black organization that would stand against a lot of the things to come. Okay. So we're entering now into what I'm terming the modern age, basically from the conception of the Union of South Africa up to present day.
Should we slip in some music before we start that?
Sure.
I'm going to play, I mean, most of what I've got is more recent. So this is something from the 1960s by a group called the King Star Brothers. It says it's a smooth form of mbube, which I can't find a reference to what mbube actually is. But basically, it's an emerging form of jazz. This is a style that they invented, the King Star Brothers, called isicathamaya. It's a singing style that originated from the South African Zulus. And in European understanding, a cappella is also used to describe this form of singing. So it's a cappella singing, but it is derived from Zulu singing style. Now, I'm assuming if I play this, because it came through before, I don't need to share my screen, but you're going to hear it, aren't you?
Yeah.
So here we go. It's cool. That's really, do you know what really sticks out to me there is, I don't know if you could hear, there's like a really percussive sound that they're doing in their mouths, obviously, with the consonant of k. It's like almost a clicking sound. It almost sounded like they were clapping or snapping their fingers or something, but I should maybe have shared the screen because they actually just started doing some kind of dancing that looked very, I don't know. It's like there's this Western white arrogance that kind of sees or paints that kind of the black history as being primitive. But in a musical sense, that's like really impressive stuff that's going on there, you know. Anyway,
yeah, I mean, I'm not as used to the sort of theory behind vocal music as with orchestral music, so you might be able to appreciate with like doing choirs a bit more, but yeah, I noticed it does sound quite similar to the music used by Civilization 6 for the Zulus.
Well, that's accurate.
At least like the early music, because they tend to build them up over the eras.
Yeah. I'll tell you what's quite interesting with a lot of stuff when you are just talking about music of different cultures is that obviously with my training and background, I'm very used to the westernized traditions of notation and theory, musical theory and stuff like that. But a lot of these, and you'll know as well from like Western African drumming traditions that you'll know about, that if any notation is used at all, it's very different and very, but most of it is kind of completely orally transferred.
I mean, yeah, certainly with drumming, a lot of it would be sort of group improvisation, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
That would then be transmitted through the oral tradition, I suppose.
Yeah.
Which kind of allows this sort of cultural evolution of music rather than it staying static to one person's idea written down forever the same.
That is really interesting when you look at modern sort of popular and electronic music, especially, or well, just any kind of non-classical derived forms that are more popular nowadays. there's a lot less emphasis on the notated kind of traditions, but a lot of them came from black culture through the slave industry and stuff like that.
I mean, pretty much all modern pop and rock music is based on the blues, really.
Mm.
So, and the blues obviously being heavily influenced by, I mean, basically invented by African Americans who would have had a lot of influence from the traditional music in Africa.
I actually like the way things fuse musically over time, that you've got that those two completely different worlds kind of coming together now, and more recently, where you get people that are more classically trained kind of merging the styles, with working with people from different. Go back into South African history.
No, it's interesting. I think until recently, a lot of sort of classically trained people would have been quite closed off to newer ideas and wanting things to sort of, in quite a disturbing way, wanting like European music to be like sort of pure in a way.
Yeah. It's interesting though, but I would say one of the main reasons for that is the education systems, you know, that things were very segregated, but things have improved a lot.
I'd say more recently, there's definitely been a move that I've noticed to embracing unusual things in music, not just things that wouldn't be normally considered in the Western canon, but also things like microtonality and different modes.
Yeah. Mm.
Which I don't know if most people listening to this will understand exactly what I mean by that, but there's a number of very good videos on that. Particularly Jacob Collier, I think, looks a lot at microtonality. But right. Anyway, I digress.
Yes, indeed. Back to South Africa.
So, the Union of South Africa is created on the 31st of May, 1910. It's led by Louis Botha, and is supported by the majority party in each province. The British government also supports the government and the union. It largely owes its conception to the discoveries of minerals that drive modernization, and its character is largely formed by the period of reconstruction that we just went through. After the South African War.
So it was another USA.
Sorry?
It was another USA.
Well, that wasn't supported by the British government, but yes. So the Botha administration is basically characterized by all the issues that the Constitution doesn't really answer. Which includes the uncontrolled economic growth, as well as the conquest and dispossession of indigenous peoples, which creates a lot of tension and conflict. Mm-hmm. One of the biggest sources of conflict was the relationship between employers and the white trade unions. So they actually fight in open combat for about a decade after the formation of the union, which means that the government deploys the military in 1913 and 1914. So the 1911 Mines and Works Act makes it so that certain jobs are reserved only for white workers in mining and railways. The 1913, this is basically a list of early segregation acts right now that sort of set up for the future apartheid. The 1913 Natives Land Act means that less than 10% of South Africa is designated as African reserves, basically. These are the only areas in which Black people are allowed to purchase or lease land. It also establishes that Black workers are restricted in the ways that they are allowed to live on white farms, and the terms of their contracts just get stricter and stricter.
I was talking about wondering how they justify this. I wonder, I mean, obviously, nowadays we're used to people not being, I don't think there's many, there's probably some, but there's not many people who would admit to being racist. There are some particularly hateful people that would openly declare themselves as racist. But some of these policies, you think, how did they justify it to themselves unless they were just openly racist?
Some people were.
I mean, is there a way that they kind of, you know, justified it? Like that they somehow didn't believe that they were racist, that they thought that it was just the right thing to do?
I mean, later in the 40s, when the National Party gets into power, on the platform, basically, of white supremacy, that is the idea. They openly admit that they see white people as superior and thus worthy of ruling South Africa.
Right. Because, I mean, I remember when I was a taxi driver, one of the guys I drove for, his in-laws, well, he was going out with a South African, got married to her in the end, but the in-laws had came to live. And I remember just having conversations with them. And the way they used to talk about Black people was disturbing, in that they just didn't see anything wrong with the way that they spoke about that. I actually had them say to me that they were dirty people and that, you know, they were thieves and criminals.
I mean, think about the way that you would probably not actually really find that surprising of British people today referring to Romanis or gypsies.
Well, that used to happen as well, because we had a traveller's camp near where I worked. And yeah, that was generally the
language is still the same today. Unfortunately,
I suppose the what beggars belief is when they try to pretend that they're not actually being racist or prejudiced. And you wonder, are you even fooling yourself with this? Or are you just trying to convince me that you're not? You know, it's...
Well, they try and justify it, I suppose, by saying, well, my beliefs are backed by the facts. You know, it might not be politically correct, but it's just true, which you can probably imagine an older relative saying.
Yeah,
in some way or another.
Following the logic all the way through, though, is it? I mean, if you look at statistics and you see a particular race as having higher criminal rates, you know, it's not necessarily because of their race. You know, it's like, it's kind of that they're seeing that as the reason, where actually it might just be, or probably more than likely is, that they are in a lot more poverty than anyone else.
Well, yeah. And that is the result of racism as well.
Yeah.
But there's a political and economic apparatus at play that benefits from painting certain groups of people, or, well, pitting certain groups of people against each other, basically.
Yeah. Divide and rule.
Yeah. So in 1914, as you probably know.
No.
Sorry?
We're into my granddad's lifetime now.
Yeah. In 1914, World War One begins. Britain declares war on Germany, which means as a colony of the British Empire, South Africa automatically also declares war on Germany, meaning its troops invade German Southwest Africa, or Namibia, as I'd mentioned before. However, the involvement in World War One means that a lot of the Boer generals who were quite high up within South Africa's military at this point begin to rebel. Around 10,000 Afrikaner soldiers join the rebellion, meaning the government has to actually deploy around 32,000 troops just to suppress the rebellion, killing around 300 of their own men, essentially, in the middle of World War One, which isn't the best thing. In 1914, Herzog founds the National Party, which will go on to be the white supremacist party that implements apartheid. It mainly has support from poor white workers, as well as more militant intellectuals. In 1915, the National Party gets up to 30% of the votes, with the Afrikaners largely abandoning the South African Party led by Botha and Smuts. During World War One, the white trade union miners and laborers suspend their strike action, but return to militant action in 1919 when inflation is raging. Black workers also striked a lot in this period. Even during World War One, black trade unions are set up. In 1920, over 70,000 miners from a black trade union strike in order to obtain higher wages. And this is also in response to the inflation at this time. The military and police get involved and kill 11 people in the process. In 1920, the National Party wins the majority of seats and as well as votes on a platform of republicanism. Republicanism in this sense means sort of anti-monarchist.
Right.
As well as separated education systems for Afrikaans and English-speaking white people.
Okay.
In 1921, the Chamber of Mines announced that because of the rising costs of white semi-skilled workers, they would be replaced with much lower paid black workers.
So no, just let me just get this right then. So at that point, even the whites were splintering then.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of disagreement between Afrikaners and English-speaking white people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Afrikaners, I believe, made up a majority of white people in South Africa.
Yeah.
But obviously not the majority in South Africa, as black people didn't really have representation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So in 1922, a miners' strike is escalated into a nationwide strike and an armed uprising. Strikers become commandos, and this becomes known later as the Rand Revolt.
Okay.
Jan Smuts, who had been prime minister since Botha died in 1919, uses both artillery and aircraft to crush this Rand Revolt and kills about 200 people in the process. So quite significant, like, labor disputes going on here, where there's artillery being used to suppress it.
Yeah.
In 1923, the Native Urban Areas Act makes it so cities are segregated, and black people's access to cities is restricted by influx controls. Okay. So the conflicts that had been raging for a long time between the employers and white trade unions end largely in 1924 when the Industrial Conciliation Act is put into place. This basically sets a standard to regulate labor disputes rather than having open conflict, which is kind of preferable. In 1924, Herzog, who leads the National Party, becomes prime minister. This is when the National Party enters a pact with the Labour Party. So since the Reconstruction following the South African War, a lot of landless Afrikaners begin to flood into cities, which sort of creates the movement for the second language, basically making it so it's not English and Dutch that are the official languages, but English and Afrikaans, meaning that Afrikaans is separate to Dutch, even though they're relatively similar even to this day. So this movement is largely led by teachers as well as members of the church and journalists. They succeed in 1925. Afrikaans replaces Dutch as the second language of South Africa. So throughout the first two decades of this union, segregation is everywhere. There are just endless barrages of legislations that regulate the relationship between class and race as the black population grows. So in 1926, Herzog travels to London, where the Balfour Report gets released, and this allows dominions such as South Africa, I think also Canada, probably Australia, and possibly New Zealand. Basically, it allows them more autonomy in foreign affairs. And when Herzog returns, he creates more symbols of nationalism for South Africa, including the old flag, an anthem, protective tariffs, and subsidies for agricultural exports, as well as state-owned iron and steel industries. Are you wanting to do the next piece of music soon?
You just mentioned about the anthem, and I'm just reading about the current national anthem. Because it's apparently, since 1997, been a hybrid song, combining new English lyrics with extracts of the hymn and former anthem, The Call of South Africa. So it may not be the same one that I played when I played the Cry Freedom thing. Anyway, I don't know. How are we doing time-wise? Do you think we're going to get through it in this episode, or are we going to be...
I think we could probably get up to like the 1940s, where like the National Party actually gets into power, and then hopefully wrapping up in a third part, but I don't know if we could get through all of apartheid in that time.
Right, I'm gonna bring up some Hugh Masekela. Don't know if you've heard that name, have you?
No.
Okay. Hugh Masekela, soul and jazz were big things in South Africa, and a lot of it came out in the 1960s. Apparently during that time it split into two fields. There were dance bands, which were popular white avant-garde jazz inspired by the work of John Coltrane, Thelonious Monk and Sonny Rollins. But Hugh Masekela got big. I've heard that name before. Hang on. I'm going to play some while I just... Right, Grazing in the Grass. Oh, hang on. I'm just waiting for an ad to play through. Okay, skip ad. Here we go. Right.
Thank you.
because the reason that I picked Hugh Masekela was because I have heard that name before, and I'm pretty sure the only person to have ever scored a number one on the flugelhorn.
Huh.
And I think that might have been it that we were listening to there. It's called Grazing in the Grass from 1968.
And quite nice.
It was, hang on a second. 1968. It reached number one on the Billboard pop chart, apparently.
Nice.
There you go. That's my contribution at this point.
Cool. Should I continue?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. So the white trade unions that were previously sort of more militant become bureaucratic. The unskilled white laborers can get sheltered employment through public works, and there are now set minimum wages for the private sector. However, poverty is still quite high, even among white people. But the new policies mean white people can get more jobs, but black people didn't really have much to get money. The situation of black people quickly deteriorates with segregation to the strict terms that are required to live on white-owned farms means that a lot of people are forced to, well, they either have to follow these very strict terms or live in urban slums where the conditions are even worse.
Yeah.
The Industrial and Commercial Workers Union, shortened to ICU, is a mass black political organization, and this grows in response to the deteriorating economic conditions of black people. And so this begins to sort of collect specific local grievances with this call for the return of land to black people and the liberation of black people.
Mm.
So we actually get to the Communist Party of South Africa here, which had previously mainly been operating in white unions, begins recruiting black members a lot more. And in 1928, changes to call for black majority rule, beginning to establish close ties with the African National Congress, or ANC.
Mm-hmm.
So in 1930, this leads to a bit of a split within the ANC because the more moderate members begin to expel the ones that wanted to work with the Communist Party. This sounds quite familiar. Our current Labour Party in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
So now, by 1929, the election is dominated by native policy, basically the policies that each party had to black people, essentially. The Afrikaner politicians use the term black peril as a campaign slogan and the communist menace quite a lot. They would continue to use these terms for years to basically justify them being in government. Just incidentally, in general, anti-communism, although I understand people's oppositions to the sort of form of communism under the USSR or the People's Republic of China, generally, when used as this sort of political slogan, is a prelude to fascism, which in this case it is. In the case of Indonesia, it was.
Yeah.
The case of Portugal, it was.
Yeah. America used to call it the Red Peril, didn't they, during the Cold War?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they used that to basically justify removing political opponents in some ways.
Yeah.
So, yeah, in general, when you hear people sort of being using sort of anti-communism to justify a bunch of things, it's generally, to my eyes, because they're wanting to introduce fascist policies and slip it by for the purposes of security against communists.
What you mean, like the sort of thing which sees you being able to remove somebody's citizenship without telling them?
I mean, they're not like explicitly anti-communist, but see, the weird thing with that, it's not even like anti. I mean, it's clearly aimed at certain people. It's not going to be used against lockdown protesters, probably. Or vaccine protesters. But they don't use language as like, oh, we're doing this against the environmentalist nut jobs or anything.
Be careful, because at some point, if you get too carried away, you're going to end up with a reputation, because you're going to start getting swathes of British refugees moving elsewhere. Or ex-British, should we say.
Well, that was actually a thing that I noticed a lot of people in England who support Scottish independence were like, yeah, if Scotland becomes independent, I could absolutely see myself moving there.
Yeah,
as just a way to get away from the UK.
Mm. Well, I mean, I know this is a bit of a digression, but for quite a lot of the same reasons that I would favour Scottish independence, I think the difference in political compass, I think England could find itself far more extreme without Scottish influence in Westminster.
And there's a certain point, though, where it's sort of like, well, people are voting for that, though, so...
Yeah. So again, did you see what Jacob Rees-Mogg called Douglas Ross?
Oh, God.
Well, Douglas Ross has been, leader of the Scottish Conservatives, been calling for Boris Johnson to resign. And Jacob Rees-Mogg says, oh, he's always been a lightweight. Fucking idiot. Anyway, please, carry on with South Africa.
Yes. Okay, so in 1931, the British government passes the Statute of Westminster, which allows a bunch of Commonwealth nations... legal authority separate from Britain, including South Africa. 3 years after this, the Parliament of South Africa declares itself to be a sovereign independent state, essentially sort of setting up that they kind of want to distance themselves from both the UK and the Commonwealth in general. Sorry, were you going to say something?
No, I was just saying, I was...
Okay.
I think there's a slight delay on this line that's maybe causing...
Right. So the National Party does still hold a majority in the Assembly, but with the Great Depression at this time affecting the whole world, and also Herzog government not really handling that very well, they go into coalition with basically his rival, Smuts, who leads the South African Party.
Who?
Smuts.
Smuts.
I think Jan Smuts, I'm not sure.
Okay.
Basically, it would be like if Labour and the Tories went into coalition.
Mind you, that's probably more likely at the moment than at least with half of the Tories. Carry on.
I mean, this is something in a lot of countries that it's kind of seen as like a point where like you sometimes have these coalitions for national unity. It happened in Germany. The last government was a coalition between the two biggest parties.
You probably got maybe the elements of the left who are more centrist joining with the elements of the right that who are more centrist because of more radical aspects within their own party, yeah?
Yeah. But actually, these parties, which would be even more unheard of. In 1934, the National Party and the South African Party merged to form the United Party.
Okay.
So this would be like if Labour and the Tories just became the same party.
Right. You begin to wonder who would the opposition be?
One guy from the National Party was kind of pissed off with this, and a bunch of people followed him, and he kept the National Party running in the meantime, while this United Party was running. So they had Herzog as Prime Minister and Smuts as Deputy Prime Minister. They both these parties were basically governed together because they have a common interest, which was to favor the enfranchised population pretty much by this point almost completely white people over the unenfranchised population, who were all black people. As I said before, women were given the vote in 1930.
Right.
The National Party is continued by a guy called Daniel Malan, who disagrees with the idea of the merger. So the United Party agrees to provide massive support for white farmers, providing poorer white people with jobs that are protected from competition from cheaper black labor, basically, and also further restrict the movement of black people from the reserves that they've sort of been cattled into at this point into towns. So back in 1926, Herzog had actually proposed that black people be completely removed from the Cape's common role, and also the reserve areas increased, I suppose, to allow more space to move black people out of towns. And this actually becomes law in 1936 with the Natives Acts, which means that black voters in the Cape basically get a separate voters list where they elect their own representatives, who are all white still. They just get free white representatives for all black voters.
It's just ridiculous. Sorry. Beggars belief that this shit actually happened. But I mean, you gotta wonder how much of what we go through now will be looked back on in 100 or so years, and they'll be like, what the fuck was going on in their minds?
I think there's a lot of people doing that right now.
Well, yeah. I suppose the difference is nowadays there's a lot more of the population that have direct immediate access to media.
Yeah. And also direct access to being heard by so many people.
Yeah.
Which you wouldn't, I mean, television at this point wouldn't have even been widespread.
No, definitely not. You'd be talking about newsreels in the cinemas for most people, I think, would be, I don't know, a week or two out of date by the time you got newsreels and stuff.
Yeah. So the US and the UK at this point abandoned the gold standard, which actually causes South Africa's gold, the value of South Africa's gold to skyrocket, which means a lot of money for white farmers, quite rapid growth in towns, the diversification of the economy. So the standard of living for white people at this point greatly increases, but for black, colored, and Indian people, basically nothing changes. The conditions on reserves, which were still kept under around 13% of the land.
Are you trying to tell me that trickle-down economics doesn't work?
Yes, and also especially not when it's segregated, so that the majority of the population never sees any of the wealth. Yeah. Oh, wait.
Yeah.
So, yeah, on reserves, overpopulation is rife. And because of the sort of small area that you've got to work with for actually producing food, soil erosion becomes a big issue.
Right, okay.
So the government responds to this problem in reserves by enacting betterment schemes, which basically involves culling cattle and building contour ridges, which are supposed to reduce soil erosion. But they also keep tight control of land use within the reserves, which I imagine was just used to even more harshly restrict what black people were allowed to do on the little small parts of land they were allowed to even own.
Yeah.
So the overcrowding meant most black people had to go to work in white towns, which were hostile to their existence, basically. They were isolated in small groups where they couldn't really organize, and their wages were about 12 times smaller than white workers doing the same jobs. Black people could only really get education through Christian missions. I mean, you laugh, but like, it's quite an important thing to a lot of countries where,
yeah, I suppose,
you haven't really got educational institutions for a lot of people.
No, but it kind of has to come hand in hand with what they're preaching.
Yeah.
Just as an aside, I had to laugh when I found myself at the co-op earlier buying a bottle of wine and a loaf of bread. I thought, I'm turning Catholic. Yeah.
You'll be confessing your sins soon.
No way. they're mine. They're up here. They're staying here.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I'm not going to make that joke. I'm not going to make that joke.
Oh, now I'm intrigued.
I'll tell you later if I remember.
Best not to air dirty linen in public.
So the Christian missions only actually had enough funding to enroll a fairly small number of black people. But they, at this time at least, were running schools and high schools, which were good enough to take some pupils to university, which means a small number of black people could become teachers, join the civil service, or join the church as clergy members.
Oh, right, okay.
Which allowed sort of greater political involvement as educated black people got engaged in politics in the ANC. But they still had little political power, and neither did colored or Indian organizations. Yeah. At this time, they were trying to use more just legal methods, whereas the ICU, which had collapsed in 1930, which was tied to the Communist Party, was using more radical solutions. And so that no longer had the same ties to black people. Okay, so we get onto World War II now. So Britain declares war on Germany in 1939, as you probably know. So the United Party is kind of split on this issue. Herzog, who's the Prime Minister, actually wants South Africa to be neutral in World War II. But Smuts, his deputy prime minister, wants South Africa to join Britain in World War II against Germany. Smuts' faction narrowly wins the debate, and Herzog and his followers basically leave the United Party to rejoin the National Party, which had been maintained by Milan. Smuts becomes prime minister because of this, and South Africa declares war on Germany again.
Mm-hmm.
South Africa makes quite a lot of significant contributions to the war effort. with around 135,000 white people fighting in both East and North Africa, as well as Italy, and around 70,000 black and colored people serving as mainly laborers and drivers.
Right.
I suppose there's generally like a taboo against giving black people arms that they could possibly use to fight with. The South African resources, which consist of uranium, platinum, steel, become quite valuable to the war effort. Mm. When the Mediterranean is locked off to Allied forces, South Africa is basically used to supply the ships that are going up to the Suez Canal.
Right.
The war actually ends up boosting the South African economy, but there's quite a lot of inflation and the wages aren't changing with inflation, which causes a lot of protests and strikes by the end of the war.
Mm.
Manufacturing and service industries expand during the war, which means a lot of black people are now in towns that wouldn't have been before. To the point where black people in towns now outnumber the white people in towns, most living in camps on the outskirts of cities, as they're not allowed to live in the towns themselves.
Were they called townships?
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
So this being sort of grouped together and in towns allows black people political power. Mm. They managed to boycott a bus company, form trade unions, and over 60,000 gold miners go on strike in 1946 for higher wages and better living conditions. This strike is brutally suppressed, but the government begins to make some concessions, although still maintains segregation.
Yeah.
They ease something called the industrial color bar, increase black wages, relax the past laws that had restricted the rights of black people to live and work in white areas. But at no point were black leaders consulted about these concessions, so they're kind of a moot point, if you will. Afrikaners apparently feel threatened by these very small concessions. They create ethnic organizations, form economic associations, federations of Afrikaans, cultural associations. They even create a secret society called the Afrikaner Broederbond.
Okay. Secret until...
Sorry?
Secret until when? I mean, clearly we know about them, so...
Well, I assume it got uncovered at some point. Throughout the war, throughout World War II, many Afrikaners actually supported Germany, perhaps for reasons down to like white supremacy. And a number of Afrikaners actually sabotaged Allied war efforts. So the United Party enters the 1948 election quite complacent. It doesn't really take a strong stance on racial policy, but the National Party, now led by Milan, has a very strong white supremacist stance, explicitly calling for apartheid and the tightening of segregation and discrimination. The National Party manages to win the election by a narrow margin. And so after this, the National Party tightens its grip on the state and win successive elections with bigger and bigger majorities. I'm going to see if we're getting close to a convenient point to stop.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that sounds like a fairly convenient place if we're getting on towards apartheid. Sounds like a fairly decisive turning point.
Yeah.
Not
I'll get to I'll get to 1950, I think, because there's something quite important that happens there.
Okay.
Okay, so the ANC Youth League, which had sort of emerged in the 40s, basically kickstarts a revitalization of the ANC. They have a new president, Albert Luthuli, along with three younger men, Walter Sisulu, Oliver Tambo, and Nelson Mandela.
Hey, somebody I have seen in real life.
I'm sure you said that last time, yeah, but I'd forgotten.
Probably the most famous person I've ever seen. I mean...
probably the most famous person I've ever seen was Dara O'Brien.
I probably have actually seen the Queen at a distance. But I would say Nelson Mandela, in historical terms, may at least be on a par with the Queen in terms of fame. I mean, I know she's
yeah.
the longest ruling monarch of the UK, but I think history will probably look back on Nelson Mandela as, well, certainly more influential.
Yeah. I mean, she's mainly known because she's the current monarch, but I don't know what her legacy will really be. So the government makes it compulsory for white children to be educated in their home language. So this begins raising the living standards of Afrikaners up to the same level of English-speaking white people.
Mm.
In 1949, the Prohibition of Mixed Marriages Act is introduced, and in 1950, the Immorality Act is passed.
The Immorality Act, for fuck's sake.
Basically, this makes interracial marriage and sex illegal.
And sex?
Yeah. Well,
believe.
There's kind of a idea here that sex leads to children, and white supremacists hate nothing more than mixed black and white children.
Polluting the bloodline. I mean, it's like, I suppose the logical conclusion of that is basically what we have as the royal families across Europe. It's like...
Yeah. I mean,
no, I'm not going to say that. There's an ongoing legal position with that, but...
What, Prince Andrew?
Yeah, it was related to that, but I don't want to get done for slander or whatever it is in this case.
I don't think you will.
age doesn't matter.
We're getting to the sort of turning point here where like apartheid has really started. So in 1950, the man who's largely responsible for making apartheid real, sort of enacting the National Party's vision, is Dutch-born Hendrik Verwoerd. He becomes Minister of Native Affairs in 1950 and will go on to become Prime Minister, I think, later in the 50s. I'll see just quickly. Yeah, in 1958, he becomes Prime Minister. So this is kind of where apartheid and the situation of black people quickly escalates, if you will, with just successions of acts that just limit every aspect of life for black people.
I mean, obviously things have been unacceptably unfair for a long time, but it seems like there comes a tipping point where it suddenly accelerates to something, just something else, you know?
Yeah.
So are we at a stopping point?
Yeah, I think so. I had kind of hoped to try and do each country in two parts, but...
Oh, don't worry about it. South Africa's got some very intricate history, obviously.
I kind of figured we'd be rushing through a lot of quite important discussion.
Yeah, a lot of it will be in this next section. I mean, obviously, a lot of it's been in this section leading up to this one, but certainly since apartheid started.
That also gave me an idea, just sort of for the general format of these things, to add the years covered to the title, just so people can look and be like, oh, I'm interested in that part of South African history. Yeah. What parts did they actually cover?
Yeah, good idea. Well, I shall look into that. And but I'm going to see with the national anthem that I'm going to play this time. To finish off with, I am going to, I know it might seem like it's really dark and pessimistic where we're at with the history of, and it is, but I'm going to try and be a little bit more positive because the version of the national anthem that I played last time from Cry Freedom isn't actually the national anthem as it is now. Because since 1997, it's been a hybrid song combining new English lyrics with extracts of the former anthem, which the Call of South Africa, which I've said before. But apparently it's the only what's known as a neo-modal national anthem in the world, meaning that it's the only one that doesn't finish in its home key. And the lyrics that are used now employ the five most widely spoken of South Africa's 11 official languages. The first two lines are, I don't know how to pronounce this, X-H-O-S-A, I don't know.
Xhosa.
The Xhosa, okay. That's the first stanza, the first two lines. The last two lines of the first stanza are in Zulu. The second stanza is in Sesotho. The third stanza is in Afrikaans, and the final stanza is in English. So apparently, there's some history about the original one, but the South African government under Nelson Mandela adopted both songs as national anthems from 1995 until they were merged in 1997 to form the current anthem. So will I go ahead and play it?
Sure.
Oh, yes. Quite moving.
Yeah,
changes language and changes key. It's like, I mean, because obviously, you know, within my lifetime, South Africa as a country, while its borders may not have changed,
they did actually.
Okay, right. Well, certainly,
because they still owned Namibia
okay.
for a long time after the First World War.
Probably in the next episode, but I mean, as an entity, it feels very much to me, who's not very politically kind of aware, but certainly when apartheid came to an end, even though it was called the same thing, it feels like the country as it was came to an end and a new country was born. That's how it feels, having seen it happen, you know. So,
I mean, effectively, in terms of official sort of titles and stuff, it did, yeah. I think. I mean, a new constitution was drafted, which is kind of quite symbolic of there being a new country founded.
Yeah.
Just as a note, by the way, on we talked a little bit earlier about Desmond Tutu, which we'll talk more in the next episode about, because he sort of becomes more important towards the end of apartheid. I thought it fitting, given a lot of criticisms of him during his lifetime, around anti-Semitism in inverted commas, where he'd compared the situation of Palestinians in Israel to apartheid that he'd fought against in South Africa, which I thought, just because we're talking about the sort of the way that people justify racism, I would think to look at the way the Israeli government and its supporters justifies its actions against Palestinian people as sort of matters of security and talking about the right to be there where land has been stolen effectively.
Yeah.
For different reasons, of course, but under similar circumstances, and as we'll get into, under similar rejection by the international community in a way, although in the case of Israel, protected by American interests, South Africa didn't really have those allies.
Anyway, I am desperately in need of the toilet. So, shall we draw?
Fair. Sure. Anyway, I have been Firebolt.
And I've been the Orbiter.
And this has been South Africa Part 2. Hope to see you in the next part, where we cover from 1950 up until the present day.
Yeah, that's over 70 years now. How did that happen? Anyway. Yeah, sorry. Bye.
Bye.
I can't do much after birth because I'll wet myself.
You want to stop recording?
Okay. Bye, pupil.
This podcast is part of the After Dark Podcast Network.